will represent our last auditorium vision program, vision series program for the year. We do have the Lion King trip scheduled for this Saturday to Fox. By the way, as far as things have changed, we have a few seats left on the bus. And for students, it's a $10 fee, which includes transportation and tickets. Tomorrow afternoon, we'll open it up to the community. We have a waiting list of community folks who want to go on the trip. And anybody in the community would like to go, we'll leave 8 o'clock in the morning, Saturday morning, and we'll probably get back by 9 o'clock in the evening. We'll eat lunch on the way up. We'll take the Fox, see the program, and eat supper on the way back. It'll be a great day. And if you've never seen The Lion King, it's the staging is fabulous. It's amazing how they create the characters, the animal characters on stage and so forth. There's still some seats available if you're interested. This morning, I'm happy to welcome to our campus Dana Lynn and Kyle Sana, who comprise what's called the Celtic Duo. The great diversity that makes up music Americana, one of the basic strands is the Celtic tradition. And you can hear it all the time, even in popular music and folk music and so forth. And this duo has a strong interest in that type of music as well as other music as well. They have a particular interest in this. They've played in the United States and Canada. They are composers, performers, arrangers, recording artists. They've been involved in television and film programming. They play clubs and festival stages and concert halls and college campuses, and of course this morning they're going to be at East Georgia State College. So at this time I want you to welcome Dana Lynn and Kyle Sana, the Celtic Duo.
Thank you. state already. We're from New York City, actually. And we're going to be, like John said, we're going to be playing some Celtic music, mostly Irish music. These are all tunes that were made to fit dance steps. And the last one was a dance form called Reel. And we're gonna play our own interpretation of an old tune that has the Irish title, En Buchal Droicha, which translates strangely a little bit as The Withered Boy. And it can be played in two different types of dance tunes. One is a barn dance, and one is a jig. And we loosely interpret the barn dance, then we go into a more traditional jig. And I think Dana will explain more of those, how the rhythms work with the dance steps. This is The Withered Boy.
Thank you. been raining. But it's still so beautiful, and you know, I think you still have your spring a lot sooner than we've had ours up in New York. So it's very beautiful here, actually. All sorts of amazing flora and fauna. So we just played something that went from a barn dance into a jig. And for anyone, I don't want anyone to be completely unaware of what we're doing, but these are all tunes that people dance to, as Kyle had mentioned, and we're taking our liberties because there's no one dancing on us, but not to say that you know, if you would like to. There is so much space. And I guarantee it will sound great, even if you, especially if you have hard shoes on, it would just be great. But we're taking a couple of liberties because there are no dancers telling us to keep going. I started playing music when I was really young, and I played a lot of classical music, and then actually one of the things that drew me to traditional Irish music was the fact that you got to play for dancers a lot. And even though sometimes I think about it, I'm like, my goodness, I can't believe I used to do that, because the dancers, they were usually 4 hours long, and it was constant playing, like constant. And but there was a great energy about it, and it's usually with drums and piano, and like a lot of people playing tunes, sort of full steam ahead, people having a great time. And there's something it's like such a rush compared to your normal classical situation, which to me, quite frankly, kind of made me so nervous that half the time I would be sick before playing. It's just terrible. So that's one of the main appeals about this sort of the difference for me. But we're gonna continue on with a couple of different dance tunes. These are called hornpipes. And the way I would explain them, if you think about the tunes in your head, well, jigs are sort of like pineapple, pineapple, pineapple. You could pick any, you know, you could say Swainsboro, Swainsboro, Swainsboro if you want. And so then, like, a hornpipe would be more like Georgia, 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 or actually, the fruit analogy, I would just say apple, 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 etc. And so we're going to continue on with two dances called hornpipes. I'm actually not sure what the names of these are. There's thousands and thousands of tunes, and I think each tune has about 6 different names, so you'd think I'd remember one, but I haven't. So here we go. Thank you.
some of you might have recognized where that last tune came from. That was Johann Sebastian Bach. A piece that he wrote for a solo cello, actually. And he also wrote in for dances, you know, all these different dance forms and creating suites together, which is really what traditional Irish players do as well. And we've adapted that in our own style a little bit. That type of dance tune is called a jig, and it's got that same pineapple rhythm, pineapple, only very fast. And we went from a traditional Irish jig into Bach's jig. We're gonna now play a composition by an Irish harpist named O'Carolan that was actually a contemporary of Bach.
musicology classes and whatnot, and there fell in love with a couple of records, mentioned them to a friend, and then who said, well, you know, the Judaic studies professor, Miles Crasson, is a great Irish fiddle player. So, as it happens, this Judaic studies professor was this amazing player and also very very scholarly in this particular pursuit, and edited a complete collection of Irish tunes that were like first published in 1908 called the O'Neill's Book of Irish Music. And that collection was compiled by someone who was a police chief in Chicago. And he had like fastidiously gone around to everyone he knew, had them play all the tunes they knew, then he transcribed them all, and then got them published. And you know, if you did something like that now, it would be so much easier with all the technology you have. But at the time, in 1908, it wasn't that easy. And he also, I mean, he was a police chief. He had a jail with a bunch of criminals in it. And, some of those tunes actually came from the people in his jail, which I thought was kind of interesting. They were nice enough to oblige. That was amazing. maybe they got out free. I don't know. Who knows? But anyways, these next couple of tunes are from that collection. And the first one is called The Clue Reel, and the second one is called Western Lasses. So here we go.
Thank you.
going to now play an Irish air. And an air is typically an unaccompanied song, so a singer singing alone without accompaniment. And they often tell stories. But instrumentalists also play airs. And we're going to do one that's called After Aughrim. It commemorates the Battle of Aughrim. And we're going to go from that into a tune, which is a reel, called Follow Me Down. And these two tunes, and most of what we're playing is, we recorded a record that has a little narrative theme throughout it. And the title of the record is called The Hare Said a Prayer to the Rainbow and Followed the Fox Down the Bowl. And we chose tunes that sort of fit thematically with our narrative. So we're going to go from After Aughrim into Follow Me Down.
Thank you.
we're actually, the rabbit does not fall down the hole, chases the fox down the foxhole, which is, of course, a terrible idea. But in the story, you know, the hare is in love with the fox, which is also a terrible idea. But then I guess, you know, maybe animals don't choose who they follow either. So there's no morals. We have no morals to tell here. It's okay. We're going to continue on with some logic, and not too much to say about these except that they take us to a more normal place than that particular selection. So the name, actually I got all of these out of O'Neill's collection to be, the first one is called the Kookanandy, and the second one is the Dusty Miller, and the third one is called the Boys of Alasdair. Okay.
Thank you.
they're on a weekly basis at different pubs, and people come to play tunes and learn new tunes and just be around that general atmosphere. And so we met at one of those. The New York City has a really pretty broad and lively Irish music scene and community. And but as big as it is, eventually you meet the players. And we met a long time ago, but we didn't really start playing as a duo until 2 or 3 years ago. When we made this record, we brought some CDs here. If anyone's interested, we'd be happy to talk to you, meet you, sign them, whatever. So we made this record and then started touring and developing this material, and bringing that music, which is typically heard in people's homes and in pubs, to concert stages like this. Anything else to say about our band? Yeah. Any other questions? There was one back there.
I was going to ask about CDs.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, here we have one. Just come talk to us afterwards, but this is our CD. Dana did the artwork, which is really lovely. You can hear most of what we're playing today on here. Come talk to us afterwards. We're selling for $15. And we are going to be back in Georgia next March. We're actually planning on St. Patrick's Day. If you guys want something, a way to celebrate St. Patrick's Day, make a trip up to Augusta. We're going to be in Augusta. And we'd be happy to take your email if you want us to notify you, or on our website, which is danalynkylesanna.com. You can also join our mailing list there and enter in. If you live in this region, we'll let you know for St. Patrick's Day next year.
Can you explain, do you prefer one violin for classical music and another for fiddle music, or do you have just one favorite violin?
I separate just because it's a little bit easier for me. And it's actually not that, there's set up in the same way, it's just actually a sound thing. This one is quieter, and it's also, not that you can see it, it's a very subtle thing, but it's fitted so that I can stick a little contact mic in the bridge, and the other one is not. So this one also has a smaller neck. Generally people like flatter bridges and this type of thing, but I don't really, doesn't bother me so much. And actually the main thing for me is the bow. Having said that, I use just one bow. So yeah. And the strings. The strings are also a big factor. Like these on my classical violin, which I do pretty much everything else on, the strings are heavy gauge and these are medium. So it's not even that much of a difference, but it's enough for me to feel it, because it's a different, this is like constant playing, and in other types of music it's not as constant. So any other questions that we can field? Hello.
Are either one of you of Canadian origin?
No. Why do you ask out of curiosity?
I was in Atlantic Canada several years ago, and Celtic music was everywhere.
Yeah.
It is. We've been there quite a bit. We've been to Nova Scotia, and we were in Newfoundland for 2 weeks last year, maybe the year before, which was, there were ice storms and crazy, all sorts of crazy weather. And actually, we've been outside of Montreal and in Ontario, so there's a huge tradition of fiddle playing there, like different types of fiddle playing, whatever. Or Canadian, yes?
Yeah.
How did you get interested in Irish music? Did you get approved to
Ireland? When I was at cheapio person, I would say yes, but I'm not. I don't have any. Personally, I don't. My parents are from Taiwan, which is, you know, a smaller island than Ireland. And believe me, when I came home, like, playing fiddle tunes, my parents were like, what are you doing? They're still kind of like that. They're still like, it all sounds the same. It really does all sound the same to them. Like, sometimes they're like, we need to see, my dad is sort of an amateur piano player, so he's like, I need to see some notes. I just don't get it. Which is fine, because lots of people say that about classical music too, but no, I don't have any roots. I've been there a lot, and it's a lovely place, but it's also, you know, the first time I went there, I was, I think, 21, and I hitchhiked all over the country, and there was no internet or blah, blah, blah. It was a lot harder to get around. I had like 5 phone numbers, brought a tent, backpack. I was, you know, I'm a vegetarian, so I think I ate cheese sandwiches for about 3 months. And then there was this one time when I saw a Chinese restaurant, I was like, oh, thank goodness. And I went and ordered a vegetable stir fry, and they served it to me over French fries. It's very disappointing.
Set of reels. Thank you all so much for listening, and thanks John Durden for hosting us.